So if we only look at the data, especially for sentiment analysis, if you only look at the textual content, it is about the topics, like by analyzing the meaning of the words. But for a subjective matter like opinion, and you do need to, not only the meaning of the words, you also need to understand the other side of the words, that is the sentiment that are, or the opinion that expressed in the words. So an approach that has been taken for sentiment analysis is not only doing the traditional classification of, you know, building features and doing machine learning. Often you need to consider the linguistic analysis of the sentiment side of the polarities of the words. So combining the two sides, you really can achieve better results. And of course, with the arrival of the new technology of deep learning or word representation, and you do have to learn the vector representation for words, but also really, there was a recent paper in ICML that combines the learning to represent the two aspects, both the semantic aspect and also the sentiment polarity aspect of words. I think, from this, I think a message that is not only the features from the data itself, but also external knowledge that are available that we can make use of to help with the learning process.
So anyone add something?
I may add to that. So if I understood your question correctly, when you say bottom up and top down,
So machine learning now usually
machine learning is bottom up. So you get the data, you don't know what the data is, what's about, where does it come from. You just mine it, you just process it. And I work in Internet of Things, so in IoT, and we deal with large amounts of data and large amounts of data streams. So machine learning would benefit if we know the domain. So that means semantics. So what the domain is about. So what are the peculiarities? Why are we doing this analysis? So what for? What is the expected outcome? Possibly what are we aiming at? So I would imagine that machine learning would benefit from more focus, which could come from top down rather than bottom up. So it's a combination of two approaches. So that's fine.
Sorry.
I would like to add here is that the reason why a lot of machine learning, as we call machine learning, actually supervised machine learning, in the sense that we have a correct, very clean problems, have clean labels, strong signal to train, and a lot of data. Right. So under those conditions, then bottom ups are right, because you don't need to anything else. It's a lot of data, then figure out which one is which, and then can predict very well. But under the majority of setting where we don't have that, like we don't have the strong signals, like in healthcare, for example, if you predict someone, you know, die or not, the signal is very, very weak. In the sense that they would die for a lot of reasons, rather than medical reasons, or in customer situation, they may drop out because other reasons rather than financial reasons. So we don't have strong signal. Under those circumstances, we do need external knowledge. So for example, in healthcare, we do need something, at least something like the disease tree, because the doctor has spent like 100 years classifying the disease into the 20,000 diseases, and to build a huge tree on top of that. So
ICD.
The ICD tree and other ontology. So without using those knowledge, we're missing out a lot of constraints. And other works I've done with like text, kind of topic modeling. And without using external ontologies like .NET and other things, the quality of topics are less coherent to humans. Right? It could discover a topic and it could be performing well in like likelihood or complexity evaluation, but it's non-human evaluations. So if you care about more interpretation, then those external knowledge are very useful. So the roadblock for machine learning is that in many situations, something like common sense. Let's say you know that this room has a door. If Indoleda doesn't have the descriptions, room with door, then all the machinery will fail because it doesn't recognize that actually the room has a door. So, and humans stand on 2 feet, for example. So that kind of knowledge that are very invisible. And in terms of common sense, then machine learning at this point are not using any of those models. And in many real situations, it fails. Like the other thing, like let's say, if you drop something, it falls. Right? There's nothing in that data. But a child, the children, like a baby can learn like physics very easily from like first year of life. Definitely know that if you hit something, it falls. So that kind of knowledge are not there yet. So if one of the angle right now that how to learn those knowledge automatically without any supervision, no one tell you what's right or wrong. You just observe and learn. But that one is and very hard.
So I have a foot in a different area of AI, so which is knowledge representation. So these days, knowledge representation as compared to machine learning or deep learning is it's a niche. It's not a very hot area at all. And people in this area have been talking about the drawbacks of knowledge representation in the sense that it's a symbolic way of representing world knowledge, a symbolic and logical way of representing world knowledge. And because of that, so the representation itself is quite brittle in the sense that if certain things, small things change, then a lot of things will break down. But that's not saying the knowledge representation formalism is not useful. On the other hand, I believe there's a lot of potential that could be explored in machine learning by making use of knowledge that is encoded in knowledge representation formalisms, for example, description knowledge. Description logic, where you describe concepts and relationships to these concepts in a very kind of intuitive way, which I think it's starting to be explored, but just started. I think there's a lot of opportunity in there.
Okay, thanks. So maybe can audience, if you'd like to join, if you have any questions, please ask.
Any other comments?
Or any comments?
I might just want to add very quickly in the industry, at least in practice, for many years there's been a hyper focus on supervised learning. In fact, a lot of text on machine learning actually talks about machine learning as a function that learns out of data. So there's been implicit reference to supervised learning. It's been only in recent times that reinforcement learning as an entity has started to become very popular. Although in computer hardcore computer science and gaming, computer scientists have been using that through simulations and other ways. So I see that in the future, like the example you gave, love the stone hitting, etc., it's going to become more and more accessible to the learning path when the huge dependence or attachment to supervised learning is going to be off. And people will, unsupervised learning and reinforcement learning will become, like people will become more comfortable to that. Right now, large number of industries, they can't use it properly. Apart from really experts, apart from the firms which are really expert in using machine learning in production, other companies can't use it. They are tied to supervised learning. At least that's what I've seen.
So any other comments?
I guess that's one of the problems in the way at least the academic conferences are actually publishing papers. There was a paper in 2012, was a keynote by Kiri, which actually talked about a similar problem that you called upon. So a lot of the way large number of papers are being evaluated and published, they are not connecting to the industry problem. So there are all those so-called standard data sets. They miss this exact simple thing. When hyperparameter space gets more and more complicated, it's hard to actually come up with an abstraction which actually encompasses this problem. That okay, it's going to generalize across every single domain and problem. So that problem exists. In fact, there was this track this year in ICML on reproducibility in machine learning. There's definitely a progress in that area.
Well, just for adding to what you said, just another gap between research and industry application, like what Amy talked about just now, real world execution of data science. I think, like she also mentioned, actually it was one of the KDD keynote in 2015, large scale A/B test, maybe one way.
For instance, we would like, I'm also working in the industry at SoundCloud, so we also provide testing on applying machine learning. But sometimes it's very time consuming, and maybe if you don't see the direct results, maybe you can spend months developing a feature and then putting it into production, see that well, we didn't perform that well, and then you roll back, and it would have been better if you could overcome this by other techniques. In production, in my opinion. And also, what I've noticed, a lot of A/B testing, it's done...
other side of the coin, that is using the knowledge base to help the machine learning process. Well, but, you know, I'm talking from what we did with relation extraction from natural language text. So we, if you make use of DBpedia or Freebies, it talks about the relations between entities.
Yeah. Oh, you already started. Maybe
is in the base, and you take that, you can use it
to find anywhere to park.
Automatically label, although the labels may be noisy, but you can use the entities or that appearances have appearances in the free text, and then from the large amount of unlabeled data, you can the technology is called distance supervision, that is you borrow those labels from the knowledge base and use that for training and in the learning process to improve the learning process. That's one example. And another example, topic modeling, and you can borrow for example, Wikipedia, and it gives us more richer semantics about the meaning of words, and use that to interpret and automatically label the topic models. And that's another, that's another usage of the knowledge base. Of course, I think with the arrival of the deep learning or vector representation, you can see that we have a huge amount of unlabeled data, and the knowledge base can potentially provide us ways of turn that into a supervised learning process and enrich the learning process. And I guess there are still a long way to go that we can make it use of the knowledge in a deep way in the deep learning process.
Yeah, might be a bit provocative, but supervised learning doesn't work for general things. Because you wouldn't have the name data scientist to label all the data that comes from the Internet of Things, IoT. So unsupervised learning and reinforcement learning, active learning, should be the way to go with large amounts of data. And
I think that's absolutely.
Yeah, and that's where reasoning has to work, with probabilistic reasoning has to work, combining semantic reasoning. So this is the way to go, especially in combining all these things.
Sorry, I missed the question. So.
The question, obstacles.
And
how machine learning can help semantics, or how semantics can help machine learning.
Sorry, first for being late, but most of the parkings around MIT are construction sites. I haven't been back here for a while, so.
And you couldn't find a way here?
I couldn't find my way in a place I used to come for years, right? Anyway, going back to this question, I was thinking that I mean, there's a similar question, right? And a similar question is how the data management can support machine learning, right? But
yes,
it's a very similar question
database schema.
In a sense, yeah. Right? But unfortunately, there's not many answers. If you look, and I'm not saying that the answers do not exist, but so far there is not many answers. Maybe perhaps the data management people have not quite understand machine learning and vice versa, right? But there is not a lot of bridging there. So unless we and this is a stepping stone, right? If you cannot provide basic semantics, what you find in the schema, right? At the level of machine or database schema, at the level of machine learning, then it's very difficult to talk about further things, right? More complicated things. And I'm not saying it's not possible, but it's not there right now.
Yeah, the problem is that database schema is not the absolute truth, right?
Yes.
So it represents a biased view of a database
yeah.
administrator, right?
Yeah.
So then this database
it's
schema
extreme.
May skew,
it's extreme.
Yeah,
it may skew
the machine learning process.
If you look at it from the perspective of knowledge base, it's a very extreme case.
Yeah.
Because it assumes a very closed perception of whatever the model is, right?
Yeah.
So unfortunately, there is not really a lot of progress in that area. So the question is, I'm not saying it's not possible, but at this point, there's not much here.
So from a knowledge point of view, so recently there's been a hot topic called knowledge graphs, which a lot of you should probably are familiar with. So basically, you represent in a light way common sense knowledge as a graph instead of in a relational database, where you have entities and relationship between these entities. And then you can do whatever you want to do on these knowledge graphs. You can do logical reasoning, statistical reasoning, link prediction, relation extraction, or graph completion. So there are at least conceptual representations that are very close to how we think of the world. And there are also works in the data management area on building infrastructure for supporting these kinds of data structures, graphs, basically.
So, I work in the knowledge graphs, also
yeah.
not from machine learning, but my background is database. But what I think Dimitrios was saying in terms of data schema is, I think, a lot more has more power than the knowledge graphs that are automatically built. For example, most of the knowledge graphs that we see are dynamic in nature, so it only links entity to entity, but most often you need some additional way of representing higher order relationships, right? Which I don't think, at least I haven't seen any work which explicitly learns these from underlying text, higher order relationships. Extracting them automatically and putting it in the knowledge graph seems to be a hard problem, and let alone using that in machine learning. I think in that sense, learning schema that you pointed out is, I think, a lot harder than knowledge graphs, right? And there was some earlier work on learning schema, but I don't think that has progressed. You're right. I mean, that's a serious thing that needs to be addressed.
It's not a matter of a form, because a graph is a form, right?
Right.
The matter is of a concrete use of these forms in some particular way you can extrapolate. You can always find a more general theory. You know, we can write programs to test object logic, but we don't, because it's an overkill. It's you know, you can always find a more general framework to do things. The question is, if you look at a more basic thing, which is not as general maybe, you need to, you know, at least find some evidence this can be marked. Right, I mean, I agree with you in general, yeah, the graph has a lot of possibility, right? But there's not a lot of instances of mapping in machine learning either. I don't know, maybe you're missing some literature here in the graph databases, but
Like the majors are at least 30 years old.
Yeah. long enough.
And also the schema, the point that you made about the schema is not absolute truth. I'm not very sure I completely understand that, because it's essentially every schema that you have, whether it's a knowledge graph or a database schema or anything, is task dependent, right? It depends on what you want to do with it.
The but you can describe it differently.
Sorry?
Depending on a designer's skills and experience, they can design it differently. You take three database designers and give them the same task, they will design different schemas.
Correct. But each one will probably have a different task in their mind. Assuming that we assume each database designer is equally skilled, right? If they are not equally skilled in basic design of schema itself, of course you are right. I mean, they can do a shoddy job of schema generation. But I mean is that
through the schema they express the universal discourse, the vision of the universal discourse.
Correct.
So, and it's biased, usually biased. No, it's not absolute truth. That's what I meant. That there is no ground truth that you can say, okay, this is the best possible, the optimal schema that I have.
Okay.
Also, sometimes when you're working with big organizations, they have like 500 tables and relational database, and you find that there are bugs, or some of them are violating some of the normal forms. And obviously, a data scientist dealing with that kind of data, they are not the ones who actually design it. It's the data engineers who left those bugs, and it's difficult to figure those out unless you spend 6 months or so on it, and by that, it's too late. That's also another problem with supervised learning, labeling data and so on.
I remember there was a body of work, probably 15 years old, in data mining in databases using schema. So schemas as filters. And then going back to schemas and modifying schemas based on what they mine from the database. So that's probably what you refer to.
Surprisingly, it's a good case. There are few papers on learning the schema.
I remember too, there were some papers by Larson, for example. You know, of Microsoft and Larson, that they did all of the self-designing database.
Yes.
So there is some work there, let me see.
I think we deviated from the
question. Yeah. So
should be about the money.
But they're not intuitive, right? And this produces results, actually valid results somehow, right? And but it's not the same way. So it doesn't. So if you let, starting from what you're saying, if you let people design the ontology, first of all, there are different perceptions of reality, right?
Yeah.
Second. So there will be differences there. And humans are complex. It's the most complex things we can try to model. Now, if you let the machine learning actually extract this semantics, it's more doable, but it doesn't necessarily more intuitive.
It is validated and checked. And
which is kind of against to what you say. But I'm coming from a different perspective, right? But I think that's the direction to follow. It's not designing the semantics and then supporting machine learning. The other way around, I think.
Well, it's both ways.
Yeah.
Should be convergence.
Well, potentially, but the one that's more promising to get results is the second one.
So I have just final questions, because everybody wants to curious to know, like, because now data science, deep learning, machine learning, you know, we are all talking about that. So what do you see deep learning after 5 years?
So I work on deep learning myself, so in 5 years you may not call deep learning. Well, the future is in reinvent the term itself. So I add to the point that everything goes in spirals. So machine learning has a cycle of 10 years. So 10 years ago, 2007, it was a starting point of the current wave of deep learning. But then it didn't catch on until the ImageNet challenge of AlexNet 2012. So we have 5 years, 5 years from now. So that actually the starting point. Everyone suddenly realized that deep learning is something, because it could win before it did, right? So we have 5 years ahead, and 5 years need to change itself into a different name. You could definitely invent something else to call it. So the way I see that deep learning evolves. So at the moment, the deep learning is not the same kind of deep learning that 10 years ago, because by the time I worked on the Boson machine myself, so it was the starting point of deep learning. But now no one work on that anymore. So everyone now work on neural networks, which is either you work on CNN or LSTM or Stewart's, some kind of neural networks. But then I start seeing something change, which people start thinking about more about like a cognitive science and neuroscience. So you start incorporating the memories. So one form of memory is the knowledge graph itself. So if we can find a way to represent the knowledge graph and find a way to reason with that knowledge graph within the memory, then we would use a knowledge graph effectively. But to use it, we have to learn to use it rather than like traditional logics setting with just due inference. We have to learn to use it. But that learning is still missing. Learning to use a knowledge graph is still missing. So, that said, from my point of view, that deep learning is enabling technologies right now, rather than the end goal itself. So the field itself changes. And last week, 10 years ago, I attended ICML myself. So so two things really stand out from that one. One is that reinforcement learning, right? With the DeepMind's work with robots in AlphaGo or something like that. Another one is GAN or GAN, so it's unsupervised learning again. So the field itself moving from supervised learning, which is predict something given the labels, and now try to learn to represent the world itself without any label. So GAN basically try to simulate the world so that you can tell whether it's real or not. So I really like that kind of work because I work in healthcare myself, and there's no way you can share data. Right? The only way you send data is that you can simulate the data. It's fake, but no way you can tell whether it's fake or not. Right? So the GAN is really catching the wave right now. So looking from that angle, it's not the kind of deep learning that Alex Neck gave you 5 years ago. And if you see from the work of memory networks, Turing machine, neural Turing machine, it's forefront of deep learning right now. It's not deep learning in the sense of 5 years ago people define. So the field itself reinvents, keep inventing every single year. So, and also it answered one of the questions was that how do you use deep learning in the real world? So right now we need to have PhD to use deep learning. That's a matter of fact. But from ICML conference, what I see that the industry actually dominates the field research. So that's a very good sign. It's the first time in history of machine learning that academia have little to say. Whereas Google, Facebook, Amazon, maybe one day Commonwealth Bank will have more things to say than academia. So it's kind of healthy by itself. So I'm not worried about machine learning being not useful in tactics. I'm more worried about as an academic I can do myself or join you guys in the next few years. So it's happening now.
Okay. So I think we need to
one more thing. I think that there is a lot of interest in machine learning right now, right? And what has happened before, if you look back maybe 20 years ago, there was a lot of interest in knowledge bases, for example, right? Yep. And what happens in these areas, after a period of a lot of interest, they deliver in some areas and they deliver some of these technologies deliver in some areas, and some they don't. So this reshapes actually the whole area. So at the end of this, I think all of these variations of machine learning will not be there, because they will have a test of use and time, and some of them will disappear. And it has happened, for example, in knowledge bases. This is one area that has happened, which is semantics, and so on. You know, it was very material, like machine learning. There were some issues in some of these areas and they completely disappeared. It has happened in human-inspired AI in some degree, right? It almost disappear after a lot of use in the, I would say, the 90s, and then it's back now, right? It's much more stronger and so on. So I think the, because this interest has also, they brings a lot of testing, and it brings a lot of validation, right? And the result of this validation would reshape the whole area, I think. Will not be the same area in 5-10 years from now.
If I could add to that, as we all kind of agree, it's kind of a spiral development, and it's some kind of a next spiral. We may have another name for that process. What matters is whether those things will turn into killer apps. So if there will be a tool, behind is a deploying tool, and works with the data and produces results useful to users and business and industry, then it will be a killer app. Then it will be a success story. But the main